Hello guys, I hope all of you are doing very well. So in our today's video, we will study about applications of Gauss law. It is from Standard 12 Physics, Volume 1, Unit 1, Section 164. If you are a new visitor to my channel, Pratik Singh Classes, please subscribe my channel. Do like and share my channel so that everybody can get benefits from my knowledge. And also hit the bell icon so that whenever I will upload a new video, you will get its notification in your Chrome browser or YouTube browser or any other browser which you are using. Just type youtube.com/c/PratikSinghClasses and it will take you to all the videos which I have made and it will benefit you in your studies. Okay, so fine, let us start our today's class. If you have missed your previous video, please touch the screen of the mobile phone. By that, you can see an I button at the top right corner. If you touch that I button, you can go to my previous video related to Gauss law and you can check it out there. Fine. So let us start our today's lesson, that is application of Gauss law. Okay. Electric field due to an arbitrary charge configuration can be calculated using Coulomb's law or Gauss law. Okay, so either by Coulomb's law or by Gauss law, we can find out how much is the electric field. The formula which we have derived is available in my previous video. Okay, fine. Now, if the charge configuration possesses some kind of symmetry, then Gauss law is very efficient way to calculate the electric field. It is illustrated in the following cases. Okay, here if suppose the configuration is symmetry, okay, like there is some combination of charges and that charges in a predefined shape, okay, like a two-dimensional area circle or three-dimensional sphere, cuboid, okay, or in any other shape which is symmetrical. In that situation, if you have to find out how much is the electric flux, okay, it is too much efficient to use the Gauss law. Okay, and also we have seen yesterday that Gauss law is far better than the Coulomb's law. Okay, even though both gives the same thing, but using Gauss law is easier than using the Coulomb's law. Okay, fine. So now coming to first point. Electric field due to an infinitely long charged wire. Okay, what does that mean? Okay, infinitely long, that means a wire whose length is infinite. Okay, we don't know where it is starting and where it is ending. Okay, and also it should be perfectly straight. It should not be any curved region or any curved length or shape. Fine, how to find out that? Alright, so here, consider an infinitely long straight wire having uniform linear charge density lambda. Okay, this lambda, about this we already have seen in our previous videos. If you have missed that video, let me say you once again that it means the number of charges available per unit length of the given wire is homogeneous and equal everywhere, and it is denoted by lambda. Okay, and it is written as total amount of charge by total length of the given wire. Fine. Let P be a point located at a perpendicular distance r from the wire as given in figure 1.38a. We will see it now. The electric field at the point P can be found using Gauss law. We choose two small charge elements A1 and A2 on the wire, which are at equal distances from the point P. Okay, and this point P lies outside of the wire. The resultant electric field due to these two charged elements points radially away from the charged wire, and the magnitude of the electric field is same at all points on the circle of radius r as shown in figure 1.38b. Okay, so let us see the figure one by one. Alright, so let us see this figure first. Okay, this wire is of uniform charge distribution of infinite length. Okay, a point P is taken in such a way that its perpendicular distance from the wire is r. Okay, and here linear charge density is given as lambda. Okay, suppose we rotate this point P around the vicinity of this wire, okay, in such a way that its distance always remains constant, okay, that is R, then it will become a circle. Okay, so here this is the situation. Okay, as you can see in the second figure, okay, the cursor where I am moving, this is the situation where the point P will lie when we rotate it alongside this wire at a distance R. Okay, so now what really happens here is at point P, as you can see here, which is at a distance R from the wire, okay, all the charges available on the wire will create an electric field here at point P. Okay, so as you can see here, the charge which is at this point, okay, will at a point P will create an electric field in this region, this direction. Likewise, we have taken a charge region A1 and A2. Okay, this region will also execute an electric field at point P in this direction. Likewise, A2 will also create an electric field at point P in this direction. Okay, so every point on this wire will create an electric field at point P. Every charge of the wire will create an electric field at point P, which is at a perpendicular distance R from the given wire. Okay, in that situation, we have to add all the electric fields at point P vectorially, and the resultant will be the electric field of all the charges at point P. So from the property we can infer that the charged wire possesses a cylindrical symmetry. Means you can see here in this picture that the charged wire is looking like a cylinder. Let us choose the cylindrical Gaussian surface of radius R and length L as shown in figure 1.39. Then total electric flux in this closed surface is calculated as follows, that psi is equal to close integral E dot dA, that is equal to integral E dot dA for curved surface plus integral E dot dA for top surface plus integral E dot dA for bottom surface. How does this happen? Let us see once again. Okay, so here the situation is given that we have taken the length L of the given wire, and all around it at a distance of R, it will create an electric field. So total electric field exerted by this uniformly charged wire is given by electric field on this surface, this region, okay, plus electric field at this top surface, okay, which is in the shape of a circle, plus electric field at this bottom surface. That is what given in the previous equation. Okay, so as we have discussed, now the total electric flux, okay, will be equal to this equation 1.63. okay, as we have seen from the figure 1.39 just now, that electric field is parallel to area vector, and in that situation E dot dA is equal to E dA. How does this happen? And again, for top and bottom surface, E is perpendicular to A, and so E dot dA is equal to 0 degree. Okay, so in that situation, if we apply all those terms in equation 1.63, it will give you electric flux is equal to closed integral E dA is equal to Q enclosed by epsilon naught. Why does this happen? What is the reason of this paragraph? Okay, let us see once again by the given figure 1.39. Okay, so in this figure, let us check out once again why this is taken, that electric flux is only for curved surface, not for top surface, neither for bottom surface. What really happens here is, okay, here on this surface, the electric field lines will be in outward direction because the charges here are positive, and also the area vector will be in outward direction because the normal to the region will be like this. Okay, so here E and vector E and area vector are parallel to each other. That means the angle between them is 0 degree, and so here cos 0 degree is equal to 1. So E dot dA here will be equal to EDA cos 0 degree is equal to EDA. But if you see in this region and that bottom region, what happens here is the normal to the surface, okay, is in downward direction, but the electric field is in this outward direction, that is making an angle 90 degree in this bottom region. Likewise here also, okay, what happens here is the electric field is in outward direction, but the normal to the surface is in upward direction, so the angle is 90 degree. And in both the situation, E dot dA is equal to EDA cos 90 degree, and cos 90 degree is equal to 0, so total electric flux at the top surface and at the bottom surface is equal to 0. That is what given in our previous topic. Okay, since the magnitude of electric field for the entire curved surface is constant, E is taken out of the integration and Q enclosed is given by Q enclosed is equal to lambda into L. Okay, here Q enclosed means total charge inside the curved region, because we have taken here a wire of infinite length, okay, and suppose its length, total length is L, okay, and linear charge density is lambda, then total charge available on this wire is equal to lambda into L. So Q enclosed is equal to lambda into L. Okay, here E is constant, that is why it has came outside. So psi is equal to integral EDA is equal to E into integral dA, that is equal to lambda L by epsilon naught. Here psi E is equal to integral dA, that is for curved surface, is equal to total area of curved surface, that is equal to 2 pi RL, because we have considered that the wire is a perfect cylinder and the curved surface area of the cylinder is 2 pi RL, so it has come here. Okay, now substitute this in the equation 1.65, we will get E dot 2 pi RL, that is we have seen E dot dA, that is E dot 2 pi RL is equal to lambda L by epsilon naught. From this equation we get E is equal to 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught into lambda by R, where epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space, lambda is the linear charge density, and R is the distance, perpendicular distance from the wire to a point P. Alright, so electric field in form of vector is given by E vector is equal to 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught into lambda by R into R cap. Earlier we have seen that the same electric field because of a point charge depends on 1 by R square, but here electric field because of infinitely charged wire depends on 1 by R. That means electric field because of charge, a point charge, will decrease far far higher with respect to that of infinitely charged long wire. Okay, so equation 1.67 indicates that the electric field is always along the perpendicular direction, that is R cap, to the wire. Okay, but here two things you have to keep in mind. What is that is, here on this wire we have taken only positive charges, and in case of positive charge the electric field lines goes outward, but if suppose we have negative charges, in that situation electric field lines comes inward. Okay, so when we take positive charges, okay, that means lambda is greater than zero and the electric field lines will be in outward direction, or electric field will be in outward direction. But if we suppose we have chosen negative charges on this wire, in that situation lambda will be less than zero and vector E will point perpendicular inward direction, that is given by minus R cap. All right. The equation 1.67 is true only for an infinitely long charged wire. For a charged wire of finite length, that means if we know the length of the wire is known, or if the length of the wire is not so much, in that situation the electric field need not be radial at all the points. Suppose because this wire was of infinite length, so we have taken it perfectly straight line. If suppose the wire is of finite length, it may be of any curve. Okay, in that situation, the electric field lines somewhat in this way, somewhere in this way, somewhere in this way. So in that situation, it is written here that electric field need not be radial at all the points. However, equation 1.67 for such a wire is taken approximately true about the midpoint of the wire and far away from both ends of the wire. Okay, so in that situation, even if suppose we have a finite length wire, we approximate it as infinite length wire, and then we take the assumptions given in equation 1.67, and it gives us approximately very, very equal value of electric field and electric flux. Fine. So now coming to the second topic. Alright, so coming to next topic, electric field due to charged infinite plane sheet. Okay, just imagine this sheet as it is given. This is a rectangular sheet and it is uniformly charged. You can see here that it is charged by positive charges. Okay, in such a way that electric field lines will come in outward direction. Okay, from both sides. Okay, means you have just imagine that you have a thin paper and to both sides of the paper arrows are coming out, keeping in mind that the arrows are perpendicular to the plane of the paper. That is what given here. Fine, consider an infinite plane sheet of charges with uniform surface charge density sigma. Okay, about this charge density we already have seen that it is called as, or it can be calculated as, total surface area divided by total amount of charge. Okay, let P be a point at a distance r from the sheet as shown in the figure. Okay, so you can see here P is a point, okay, which is at a distance r from this paper or from this surface. Okay, as you can see that the electric field at point P will be in outward direction, that is given by this arrow, this red color arrow, and also the area, this will be the area, or here this will be the area of the region of the paper, and the area vector will be in perpendicular direction, that normal to the area will also be in this direction. So the angle between E and dA will be in same direction. That means that is theta is equal to 0 degree. Okay, fine. Okay, so since the plane is infinitely large, the electric field should be same at all points equidistant from the plane and radially directed at all points. Okay, so radially directed means it will be parallel to the plane surface. Okay, a cylindrical shaped Gaussian surface of length 2r and area A of the flat surface is chosen such that the infinite plane sheet passes perpendicular through the middle part of the Gaussian surface, and applying Gaussian law for this surface, let us see once again what does this say about the given figure. Okay, so as you can see in figure 1.40 that this is a flat plane on which charges are distributed uniformly, and a Gaussian surface or a Gaussian cylindrical surface is taken which is lying perpendicular to the plane of the paper. Okay, and the length of this cylinder is 2r, means r forward and r backward. Okay, so here you can see that total flux is equal to close integral E dot dA. Okay, that is equal to integral E dA for curved surface region plus integral E dot dA at point P, which is at a perpendicular distance r in the forward direction or force direction, and plus integral E dot dA at P dash. Here P dash is the point at a distance r in backward direction perpendicularly, and that is equal to Q enclosed by epsilon naught. Okay, so the electric field is perpendicular to the area element at all points on the curved surface, and is parallel to the surface area at P and P dash. Okay, in that situation, we will have electric flux E psi E is equal to integral E dA at P plus integral E dA at P dash. Why? Because at curved surface, we will have theta is equal to 90 degree. So cos 90 is equal to 0, and this term can be omitted. Okay, so we will have psi E having only these two terms, that is equal to Q enclosed by epsilon naught. Since the magnitude of electric field at these two equal surfaces is uniform, E is taken out of the integration and Q enclosed is given by Q enclosed is equal to sigma into A. Here sigma is the surface charge density and A is total area or unit charge density, and we will get this as this will become 2 into integral dA. So again E will come out and we will have 2E into integral dA. Okay, so here the total area of surface either at P or P dash is equal to integral dA is equal to A. This is total surface area. Hence we can write 2 into E into A is equal to sigma A by epsilon naught, or E is equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught. So in vector form we can write electric field E is equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught into n cap. N cap means a unit vector which is like perpendicular to the plane surface. Here n cap is outward unit vector normal to the plane. Note that the electric field due to an infinite plane sheet of charge depends on the charge surface charge density and is independent of distance r. Means at whatever with the distance we take the point P, okay, it will give us the same value, that is sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Okay, the electric field will be same at any point further away from the charge plane. As in equation 1.71 here, if suppose sigma is positive, that means if suppose on the plane only positive charge are taken, then the electric field at any point P will be in outward perpendicular direction. And if suppose the plane is fitted with negative charge, that means sigma is less than zero or negative, then electric field point inwards perpendicularly, that is minus n cap to the plane. Alright, so for finite charge plane sheet, equation 1.71 is approximately true only in the middle region of plane and at points far away from both the ends. Means if suppose this section we have seen that the plane was of infinite area, if suppose we have a known area or finite region, in that situation the equation 1.71 is true only for the central region of the given area, okay, and which is lying far away from the end regions. Now the third point, electric field due to two parallel charged infinite sheets. Alright, so electric field due to two parallel charged infinite sheets. Consider two infinite charged plane sheets of equal and opposite charge densities, plus sigma and minus sigma, which are placed parallel to each other as shown in figure 1.14. So you can see here, this region and this region both having same area, okay, the magnitude of the charges on both of them are same, but in this region we have uniformly distributed positive charges and here it is uniformly distributed negative charges. Okay, so in this situation how to find electric field at a point? Here in this topic we will have three subtopics, that is if suppose the point will lie towards positive plane sheet, towards negative plane sheet, or at the center of the plane sheets. Okay, fine. So we will see this one by one here. Okay, the electric field between the plates and outside the plates is found using Gauss law. The magnitude of the electric field due to an infinite charge plane sheet is given by sigma by 2 epsilon naught. We have seen just now what does that mean. Okay, fine. And it is pointed perpendicularly outward if we have charge positive, or inward if we will have charges negative. At the points P2 and P3, the electric field due to both plates are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction, as we have seen in figure 1.41. As a result, the electric field at point outside the plates is zero. Okay, because at any point, suppose we have a plane here and another plane here. At this plane we have positive charge and this plane we have negative charge. In both these planes, if the area is same and the magnitude of the charges are same but opposite, then even if we take any point which is outward of this plane, okay, in that situation the magnitude of electric field to those points will be equal and opposite in direction, so they will cancel out each other, so it will become zero. But inside the plate, the electric field are in same direction, that is towards the right, and the total electric field at point P1, okay, that is, if suppose we have a charge here, okay, sorry, a point here, that is a point P, okay, and here, because of positive charge, the electric field lines will be in this direction, and because of this negative charge, the electric field lines will again be in this direction, okay, so here the directions are same. Then the electric field E inside the planes or the plates is equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught plus sigma by 2 epsilon naught is equal to sigma by epsilon naught. And also in this situation, the direction of electric field inside the plate is directed from positively charged plane to negatively charged plane or plate, and is uniform everywhere inside the plate. Okay, means from the direction will be from positive charge plate to negative charge plate and uniform everywhere. Okay, keeping in mind that the area of positive plate and negative plate are equal and the magnitude of the charges on both the plates must be equal. Okay, so now coming to the last topic, that is electric field due to a uniformly charged spherical cell. Okay, so here again we will have three cases, that is, if suppose we have a sphere, and what in that situation, what will be the electric field if we take any point anywhere inside the sphere, then anywhere on the sphere, and anywhere outside the sphere. Okay, so consider a uniformly charged spherical cell of radius r and total charge q as shown in figure 1.42. The electric field at points outside and inside of the sphere is found using the Gauss law. Okay, so let us see these three cases one by one. Case A, at a point outside the cell, that is when r is bigger than r. Okay, that is, if suppose we have a sphere, okay, whose radius is capital R, and we take a Gaussian surface which is lying outside the sphere at a distance r. Okay, I am sorry, I am not a very well person in drawing, so just suppose that both these drawings, both these spheres are perfectly homogeneous, okay, at a distance r, small r and capital R. So this is small r and this is capital R. Fine, so let us choose a point P outside the cell at a distance r from the center as shown in figure 1.42. okay, here we will see that figure, the charge is uniformly distributed on the surface of the sphere. Okay, that means it is called as a spherical symmetry. Hence, the electric field must point radially outward, that is, Q is greater than zero because it is taken as positive and points radially inward if the charge is taken as negative. So, we choose a spherical Gaussian surface of radius r is chosen, and total charge enclosed by this Gaussian surface is Q. Then, applying Gauss law, we will have close integral E dot dA is equal to Q by epsilon naught. Okay, when we have taken the point lying outside the sphere, okay, so the electric field E at dA point in the same direction at the points on the Gaussian surface, then The magnitude E is also the same at all the points due to a spherical symmetry. So we will have psi is equal to in E into closed integral dA is equal to Q by epsilon naught. Here E is constant, so it has come outside of the integration. And here, if we integrate area, it will be equal to total surface area of the sphere. Okay, and that is equal to 4 pi r square. Substituting this value in equation 1.74, we will get E into 4 pi r square is equal to Q by epsilon naught, or E into 4 r s pi r square is equal to Q by epsilon naught, or E is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q by r square. Okay, so in vector form we can write vector E is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q by r square into r cap. Okay, keep in mind that if suppose Q is positive, that means if the charge on the sphere is positive, in that situation we will have the direction of electric field in radially outward direction. And if suppose Q is negative, then the direction will be radially inward. From equation 1.75, we infer that electric field at a point outside the shell will be same as if the entire charge Q is concentrated at the center of the spherical shell. That means instead of, suppose we take a sphere and the charge is distributed on the surface of the sphere, in that situation we can take all the charges at the center of the sphere and cumulatively we find how much will be the electric field at any point P outside at a distance of R. Okay, a similar result is observed in gravitation for gravitational force due to a spherical shell with mass m, as we have seen in standard 11th physics volume 2 unit 6. Now in the last case we see that if suppose the point lies inside the spherical shell, consider point P inside the shell at a distance r from the center. A Gaussian surface of radius r is constructed as shown in figure 1.42b. So let us come to figure 1.42b. So the situation is just given here. Okay, what is given here is we have a sphere with charge distribution, okay, this brown color sphere, and we have taken a point P which is lying inside this sphere at a distance a small r from the center. Okay, as you, it is visible here that a small r is smaller than capital R. All right. So applying Gauss law, we have electric flux, okay, is equal to enclosed integral E dot dA for this Gaussian surface is equal to Q by epsilon naught. Okay, again here E is electric field which is uniform, so it will come outside, and dA is the area. If we integrate this, it will be equal to total surface area of the Gaussian surface, and because that is a spherical surface, it is equal to 4 pi r square. So E into 4 pi r square is equal to Q by epsilon naught. Since Gaussian surface encloses no charge, so we have Q is equal to 0, because the point P is taken inside the inside the sphere. In that situation, at point P there isn't any charge, so Q is equal to 0. Then it becomes E is equal to 0. It shows that for any point which is lying inside the sphere, we will have electric field is equal to 0. The electric field due to uniformly charged spherical shell is 0 at all the points inside the shell. A graph is plotted between the electric field and radial distance as shown below in figure 1.43. So as you can see from this graph, okay, all the cases it can be clear very much. Okay, when we have taken any point P which was lying from center to the surface inward, that is from 0 to R, electric field was 0. Over the surface, electric field was maximum. And as we go away from the surface, outer surface, electric field decreases. Okay, so this is the overall graph of the three cases. So this is the property of Gauss law. So this is the end of our today's video. I hope you must have enjoyed and have learned something more. Till my next video, keep on watching Pratik Singh Classes. Take care. Bye bye.